All right. Well, good morning, folks, and Merry Christmas. So this is in this is from Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2 is the only gospel that records the account of the Christmas star. So this is a wonderful section of history, and it's fascinating to me as an astronomer that there is a star that appears and apparently leads the Magi to the location of Christ. So let's just go through this verse by verse. I'll go back up to verse 1 and kind of exposit some of these. We won't go through all of them, but verse 1, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the name Bethlehem means house of bread, and it's fitting, Jesus being the bread of life that comes down from heaven, that he should be born in Bethlehem. The Lord loves to do little things like that. Not that it's that was a requirement for his plan, but nonetheless, it's very fitting. And this was prophesied in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Micah 5, verse 2 says, "But as for you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity." And I love that passage for a number of reasons, not only because it predicts the birth of Christ in Bethlehem, but also that last section, which not only prophesies this ruler coming forth from Bethlehem, but it's a description that his goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. And that had to seem a little bit perplexing, perhaps to the Jews of the Old Testament who didn't fully understand the gospel. They knew, they trusted in God for their salvation, but they didn't fully understand the details of the gospel. How can someone be born and yet his days are from eternity? And of course, that's a reference to the deity of Jesus Christ. And that's a verse that I use when I'm trying to argue with someone over the deity of Christ. In fact, there was a heretic that I was dialoguing with some time ago, and he didn't believe that Jesus, he called himself a Christian, but he didn't believe that Jesus is God. He believed that Jesus is a creation of God. And I asked him to account for that verse, and he really couldn't account for it. Because how can Jesus be from eternity and not be God, you see? So it's a powerful verse. So this was in the days of Herod the king. Now the thing you need to know about Herod the Great, this is not the one that had John the Baptist beheaded, that is his son. But Herod the Great was a very wicked, despicable, power-hungry man. That's what you need to know about him. And just to give you some indication of his wickedness, he had bribed his way to power. He used the Roman government. Remember, at this time, the Rome had taken over the world. All these other nations were subject to Rome, and Rome would sometimes allow them to have, often allowed them to have their own religious systems. But sometimes Rome would replace their kings with, well, in this case, Herod. And so he was able to convince the Roman government, he had friends in high positions, that he should be king of the Jews, and so that he was so appointed. And you can imagine this did not make the Jews happy. This is not their own king. This is not a Jew. Herod, as far as we can tell, is not Jewish. He had no biblical right to the throne. He's not a descendant of David. And yet he used Rome to appoint him as position of king of there in Jerusalem. Just to give you an idea of his wickedness, he had his own wife and two sons executed. Of course, we know later on in this very chapter, he had all the children in Bethlehem and the surrounding regions that are 2 years or under massacred. He murdered them because one of them was called King of the Jews, and he didn't want competition from a toddler. That just gives you an idea of how despicable this man was, that he should be afraid of a toddler. One of his own sons tried to poison him. On his deathbed, he rounded up many of the leaders from Israel and imprisoned them. He knew he was about to die. And he had orders that when he died, they die. That way there would be crying, there would be mourning in Israel. Now the order was not followed, thank goodness, but nonetheless, that gives you an idea of how wicked this man was. So this is the environment that Christ enters. And it's so neat, the irony throughout Scripture of God using things in the world that are, you know, the weak things of the world to glorify himself. And so in this time of great wickedness, when Israel was a subservient state to the wickedness of Rome, had a wicked leader, God sends this seemingly helpless baby as the Messiah to a rather poor family. It's so contrary to what we would expect, and contrary to what the Jews were expecting at that time as well. So the Magi arrive. Magi, it's where we get the word magic. They could be called magicians, but not in the modern sense of people who are doing like magic tricks or things like that. They were scholars, priests of the ancient world from the East, probably from Persia. In fact, Magi is the Persian word meaning priests. And so there's good reason to think they were from Persia. The Bible says they're from the East. Persia would be east of the Jerusalem. And so these were the scholars of their day. Of course, Persia is the region surrounding and including Babylon. So that's the area, sort of the area that they're from. The historian Philo describes the Magi as, quote, men who gave themselves to the study of nature and contemplation of the divine perfections, worthy of being the counselors of kings. And they were counselors of kings. The king, just to give you an idea of how revered, how respected the Magi were, they were wealthy as well. They wanted for nothing, right? And they, if a king wanted to know something about, well, anything, if he wanted good advice, he would bring the Magi in. They would advise kings. And that gives you an idea of how respected and revered these ancient scholars were. One of their studies was astronomy. And, of course, they would have had knowledge of all the different sciences. And you could do that back then because not much was known about science at that time. We know so much today. You have to specialize. And even, you know, my specialty is astrophysics. And even there, I specialized in a very specific subfield. I specialized in the correlation tracking of mesogranules on the solar photosphere. And that's a very specific, narrow field, but I know more about it than just about anybody. But it's very narrow. And so at this time, you could sort of know a little bit about everything. You could know about chemistry. Not that they knew about atoms and molecules, but they knew if you mix this substance with this substance, you get that reaction. They would have known that sort of thing. And to others, that would seem like magic, you see. One of their studies was astronomy. That's going to be important when we come back to what the star may have been. They would have been knowledgeable of motions in the night sky. And that's something else I should mention, too. When you think of astronomy, you probably think of planets and Saturn and rings and things like that. To the ancient world, astronomy, they didn't have telescopes. So in the ancient world, astronomy was all about knowing how things move in the night sky. And the really good astronomers could predict where things would be in the night sky, where the planets would be with respect to the other stars, and when the moon would rise and things like that, what the phase of the moon would be in advance. And so they would have knowledge of those things. And some of them were even able to predict with varying accuracy things like eclipses. And if you could do that, you were really a scholar if you could do that, because that's difficult to do. So the king, if he wanted to know when a certain celestial event would happen, he would certainly consult magi. They were the experts of the day. How many magi visited Christ? You're probably thinking, well, three. We see that on all the Christmas cards. But the Bible doesn't say, does it? It doesn't tell us how many magi. There were probably a large number of magi. We don't know how many of them. Maybe all of them came. Maybe a large section of them came to visit Christ. We don't know. But it seems likely that there were many. More than three would be likely. It had to be at least two because it's in the plural, right? So magus is singular. Magi, plural. And then there probably would have been many, 50 maybe. They had their own personal army. Yeah. So these were men not to be trifled with. And so when they traveled, you know, this little idea of these three guys on camels, Persians actually rode horseback. They were accomplished horsemen. They would have been riding on horses, maybe 50 of them, with their own personal army. Big, okay, big thing. And so when they come into Jerusalem, it stirs up some noise, especially because the Magi, because they were respected scholars, they would be consulted. If two people disagreed on who should be king, the Magi could be consulted to decide that. They had the power to depose kings, and they had their army to be able to carry out that order. And so you can imagine what Herod was thinking when this group of Magi shows up looking for the king of the Jews. Not Herod, the king of the Jews. You can imagine that he's a little bit nervous about that. It is very significant that the Gospel of Matthew records these Magi or wise men from the east, Persia being the ones who followed the star to the Messiah. I don't know if you appreciate this, the irony of that. It wasn't the Jews who were looking for the king of the Jews. It was Gentiles from a very pagan part of the world that were looking for the Christ. Isn't that interesting? And the Gospel of Matthew, I think that's why this is recorded in Matthew and not in the other Gospels, because the Gospel of Matthew focuses in on that. You know, each of the Gospels focuses in on a different aspect of Christ as the focus. And one of Matthew's main points is Christ's kingly office as the son of David. And the fact that he's king of the Jews and the judgment against Israel for rejecting their own Messiah while the Gentiles accept him. That's a recurring theme throughout Matthew. And it's hard to miss it. It's almost in every chapter. And in doing research for this, I came across an article by Dr. Ken Gentry, who is a very wise theologian of modern times, a man I greatly respect. You know, most of the great theologians are dead. The nice thing about Gentry is he's still alive, and I can ask him questions from time to time. He's a very sharp guy. And I was going to use some of this article just to inform my study of this. But the article's so good, I just want to read it. Okay, I won't read the whole thing, but I'm just going to read verbatim because I can't say it any better than Dr. Gentry has. He says, interestingly, Matthew's strong denunciation of Israel leads liberal theologians to declare it one of the most anti-Semitic books in the New Testament, written by a Jew. Interesting. Anyway, in Matthew 1, the apostle traces the genealogy of Christ to Abraham, the father of the Jews. Contrast that with Luke, of course, who goes all the way back to Adam, because his focus is different. Thus, early on in his commentary, Matthew is preparing us for the Lord's rejection by the Jews and his acceptance by the Gentiles. In Matthew 3, 9 through 12, John the Baptist rebukes the Jews for claiming Abraham as their father, contra Matthew 1, genealogy of Christ. He then warns just before Christ's ministry begins that the axe is already laid at the root of the trees, and it's an indication of judgment. It's in chapter 3, verse 10, and that he who is coming has a winnowing fork in his hand, and he will thoroughly clear his threshing floor, and he will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. This anticipates AD 70. In Matthew 8, 10 through 12, we read of the faithful Gentile who exercises more faith than anyone in Israel. We hear once again of the people from the east. This time, they sit with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the rightful place of the Jews, while the Jews themselves are cast down to outer darkness. In Matthew 9, 16 through 17, Christ teaches that the constraints of Judaism are like old wineskins that would burst with the content of Christ's kingdom. Consequently, God will provide new wineskins, the new covenant church, to contain the wine of the kingdom. In Matthew 11, 20 through 24, the Lord rebukes and warns cities in Israel regarding their judgment, comparing them unfavorably to wicked Old Testament cities. In Matthew 12, 39, he speaks of the Jews of his day as an evil and adulterous generation. In Matthew 12, 41 through 42, he once again rebukes and warns cities in Israel of their approaching judgment. In Matthew 12, 43 through 45, the Lord speaks of the sevenfold demonization of Israel in, quote, this generation. In Matthew 13, 58, he performs no miracles in Nazareth due to their lack of faith. In Matthew 15, 7 through 14, he rebukes the rabbis in Israel for neglecting God's word and teaching falsely according to Isaiah's prophecy. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts far from me. In Matthew 16, 4, he once again speaks of Israel as an evil and adulterous generation. In Matthew 16, 21, Jesus teaches his disciples that Israel's chief priests will kill him. Just think of that irony. The chief priests dedicated to the worship of the living God are the ones who are going to kill him. Ironic. In Matthew 17, 7, or 10 through 13, Jesus declares John the Baptist to be Elijah, whom the Jews do not recognize as such, and therefore kill him, just as they will Jesus. And he goes on and on in this article. It's a delightful article. But every time, Matthew is just full of judgment against Israel for rejecting their own Messiah. And particularly in Matthew chapter 21, which is one of my favorite chapters in Matthew, of course, early on, Jesus overturns the tables in the temple, right, because he's outraged at what the Jews are doing to God's temple. It throws out the money changers. Verse 19 is a really interesting one, and I'm sure you're familiar with the passage. It's one of those ones that when I was a kid, I'm like, that's just weird. It's where Jesus curses the fig tree. Remember that? It's one of those ones that sticks out, and you're thinking, why? That's weird. And I'm told that it was even out of season for fig trees to be producing fruit at that time, but it's very significant. Very significant. Jesus, the Son of God, who created that fig tree to produce fruit, and he comes to it and it's not producing fruit. And so he curses it and says, never again are you going to produce fruit then. Because when the Son of God came, you weren't doing what you were supposed to be doing. You were not producing the fruit. And you can't help but think of Israel in that context. When God came to Israel, they're supposed to be producing spiritual fruit, and they weren't. And so the implication is that God will do with Israel what he did with the tree, that Israel as a nation will no longer ever produce God's fruit. It's kind of interesting. And it's contrary to what a lot of Christians think today. Oh, you know, the Jews are God's people. Well, those that have embraced Christ are God's people, right? Yeah, but, you know, the Bible talks about branches being broken off from that tree, and we've been grafted in. But my point is God doesn't grow two trees. He's got the one tree. If Jews are going to be saved, it's going to be through the church. And just to emphasize this, when we read on, again, in the same chapter, in verses 33 through 46, Jesus tells the parable of the landowner. Remember that one where he has the vineyard and he hires people to take care of that, and then he sends them, his slaves, to receive the produce of his field, which they're supposed to be working on. And what do? They kill one, they stone another, they beat up a third and so on. And finally, what does he do? He says, I'll send them my son. They'll respect my son. And what do? He said, this is the heir. They kill him. And then, of course, Jesus asks the telling question, what do you think the master will do when he comes? And they rightly answer, he'll put those wretches to a wretched end. and he'll rent out the vineyard to those who will produce the fruit thereof. That's the right answer, of course. And so the Bible makes it clear, the religious leaders, the Jews, they knew that he was talking about them. They understood the significance of that parable. There's no doubt there. Israel, as God's chosen people, symbolized God's chosen people. Not everyone in Israel was saved, obviously, and that's the point. But they were supposed to be God's chosen people. They were not producing the fruit that they were supposed to be producing when Christ came. And as a result, God's prophesies, he says, the gospel of the kingdom will be taken from you and given to a people producing the fruit of it, which would be the church. Okay. So again, we see again the judgment of God on Israel, the people who should have embraced the Messiah, rejecting Messiah, and yet the Gentiles come in. And that, of course, God planned that from the beginning, which is interesting. He would use Israel's disobedience to bring salvation to the Gentiles. And another one of those wonderful ironies that only the Lord can think of. In Matthew 23, we get a scathing indictment against the religious leaders of the Jews, the woes to the Pharisees. In Matthew 24, a promise of destruction to the temple. It's interesting to me, too. He says, your house will be left to you desolate. In the Old Testament, the temple, God would say, that's my house. But in Matthew 23, your house. I'm not there anymore, you know. I'm tired of your sacrifices. Anyway, I could go on and on about that. But my point is, what an indictment against Israel as a nation, God's chosen people, that they were not looking for the Messiah. They either didn't see the star or didn't respond to it. The folks who responded were Gentiles from a pagan nation. These magi apparently had knowledge of the Bible. And so that raises the question, well, how? They're from Persia. They're from this pagan area, right? The Babylon area. And the Bible doesn't specifically tell us, but from other information outside the scriptures and from other information in the scriptures, we know that at one point Judah was captured by Babylon. The Jews all lived there at one point. And first of all, the Magi, being the scholars of the day, they would have had access to lots of different religious documents. They would have had their own massive library, okay? So they might have been familiar with the scriptures just on that account. But even if that weren't the case, 500 years previous to that, the Jews were there. And so they certainly would have had some knowledge of the Bible. In fact, Daniel, the prophet, lived during the captivity in Babylon. And we read in Daniel chapter 5, verses 11 through 12, of course, Nebuchadnezzar was very impressed with Daniel because he could interpret dreams by virtue of the Lord being with him, giving him the interpretation. But in Daniel 5, 11 through 12, Nebuchadnezzar appointed Daniel as chief of the magicians. Interesting. And of course, I can't help but think that those are the same. Those are the magi, that the same order. It's not the same word because Daniel's written in a different language. It's written in Aramaic primarily, and the New Testament's written in Greek. So, but I have to think that Daniel was appointed chief of the magi at one point. So the order of that group of academics was Daniel. And he certainly would have had knowledge of the scriptures. Would he have shared that with them? Of course. He's a godly man, very godly man. One of the very few major characters of scripture that nothing negative is ever said about. Kind of interesting. And it's significant, I think, that the book of Daniel records the timing of the Messiah's coming. And I could be wrong about this, but as far as I know, it's the only Old Testament prophecy that records the timing of when the Messiah's going to come. And remember, the 70 weeks are decreed upon your people. There was this decree that was issued, and then 490 years. Those are actually, it's not weeks in the literal language, is 77s, those would be years, so 490 years. And then remember, in the middle of the 69th year, the Messiah will be cut off, and so he had to be around at that time. So that gives you a time frame for when the Messiah is going to occur. And so the Magi, being the intellectual offspring of Daniel, probably would have been looking for the Messiah at that time, because they knew that time was about to happen. That 70 weeks is close to an end, and so they were anticipating the Messiah. The Jews should have been, but weren't. What about the star? They knew to look for a star, apparently. Somehow they knew the star symbolized the Messiah. How could that be? The Bible doesn't say. I'm going to speculate that it's Balaam's prophecy. In Numbers 24:17, there's a prophecy that says, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star shall come forth from Jacob. A scepter shall rise from Israel. Indicating that a king would come out of Israel, or Jacob, right? Would be a descendant of Israel would come forth, a ruler. And of course, a scepter is the symbol. You know, that's what a king holds, and that symbolizes the king. That's synecdoche, when you use part of something to represent the whole. And then that's associated apparently with a star rising. So the king rises when the star rises. It's very fitting. And a lot of conservative commentaries that I've read seem to indicate that that probably is the Christmas star. I won't be dogmatic on it, but I think that's probably what that verse is indicating. And apparently these magi would have been familiar with that. So not only are they anticipating the time of the Messiah from Daniel's prophecy, but they very likely knew about Balaam's prophecy, and they are expecting that a star rising over Israel will signify the birth of the Messiah. Then they arrived, it says, in Jerusalem. We're still in verse 1. That kind of probably doesn't make you feel real good about the timing of this, does it? That's okay. It'll speed up a little bit. They arrive in Jerusalem. Why Jerusalem? I mean, this isn't the star leading. I mean, Jesus is born in Bethlehem. Well, if the star is over Bethlehem and they're looking from Persia, you can't distinguish Bethlehem from Jerusalem. Bethlehem and Jerusalem are 6 miles apart, okay? And they're kind of east-west oriented. And so if you do the math, which I've done, if you're in Persia and you're looking that way, you can't distinguish. All they knew is somewhere in Israel, and they probably figured the capital city. But it's also interesting that they're asking, where is he who's been born king of the Jews? Where is he? We're here. Where is he? Why did they end up in Jerusalem? Because you'd think, well, at that distance, they'd be able to see the star is here and not there. But it seems to me, it seems very compelling to me that the star was not guiding them at that time. It did initially when they started their journey, but for whatever reason, when they get close to their destination, maybe it's a string of cloudy weather. I certainly know what that's like as an astronomer. And you're out of luck. You can't see any stars if it's cloudy. Or maybe they arrive during the day and you can't see the stars during the day. So in any case, they think, well, okay, we know we're close, because last time we saw the star, it's pretty high. We're getting close. And we're close to Jerusalem. That would make sense. That's the capital city. That's where you'd expect the king of the Jews to be born, right? The capital city, that makes sense. So in any case, they arrive in Jerusalem. And they ask, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? It's significant they don't ask if the king of the Jews has been born. They knew it. They knew he'd been born. And so whatever indicated to them, whatever sign that was, they were confident that it indicated the Messiah. Very confident. Because they ask where he's been born. And apparently, again, that suggests the star wasn't guiding them at that time, because they have to ask. And apparently they ask many times, because it gets back to King Herod. He finally hears about it, which suggests to me that they don't just ask one person and, oh, it's Bethlehem, and then they move on. Apparently, nobody knows. Again, an indictment against Israel. They come to Jerusalem. Hey, where's the king of the Jews been born? Oh, what do you mean? Who's been born? They didn't know. The Jews didn't know. Herod didn't know. They didn't know about the star, apparently. They didn't know the king of the Jews had been born. That must have been discouraging to the Magi, that God's own people don't know that their king has been born, the Messiah has been born. It's significant that he's born king of the Jews. Again, that's another irony. You understand, people aren't born kings. You might be born heir to the throne, but it's not until you reach a certain age that you're installed as king. Christ is different. Christ is born king of the Jews. That's awesome. And of course, he has that right. He's a descendant of Abraham. He's a descendant of Judah, which is the Messiah, you know, the prophecies that the Messiah would be descended from Judah and from David, and as such, he has a right to the throne. Contrast that with Herod, who does not have a right to the throne. There are some other scriptures that indicate that. I'm going to skip those for time's sake. It's significant that they say, for we saw his star in the east. We saw his star in the east. Not we saw a star, we saw his star, the Messiah's star. Now, of course, in a very real sense, all stars belong to God. But the fact that they single this out as his star suggests there was something unique about this. Oh, that's the Messiah's star. That's different from all these other stars. That's his star. So there must be something unusual about this star that they recognized. That's got to be Messiah's star. What could that be? I'll come back to that, because that's gonna weigh in on what this thing might have been astronomically. The fact that they recognized it as Messiah's star, his star. Some people say, well, maybe it was exceptionally bright. Maybe that's the answer. Very bright. You see that on the Christmas cards, right? Very bright star. I don't think that can be, because Herod didn't know about it. And apparently the other Jews didn't know about it. They didn't see it. Now, if it was really bright, everybody would have seen it. Herod has to ask the Magi when they saw the star, which means he doesn't know when it appeared. He doesn't know about it. And so apparently it's not particularly bright. And so I'm sorry to blow up all your misconceptions about the Christmas account, but apparently it wasn't particularly bright, because if it was, everyone would have noticed it. This, whatever the star is, it's something that Magi, who were knowledgeable of astronomy, would recognize as the Messiah's star. But apparently everyone else didn't. That could be because it could be a supernatural action of God. Sometimes God allows people who are not faithful to him to blind themselves, right? That could be it. But it could, there could be another explanation for that as well. In any case, the Magi saw the star. The others apparently didn't. And so that suggests something very unique about the star, something that that astronomers would recognize, but other people perhaps would not, or at least not recognize its significance. And it says, "For we have seen his star in the east." And I need to spend some time on that little phrase, because it's ambiguous. Does it mean we saw his star when we were in the east, right? It's kind of like if I discovered a new comet, and you're out in Hawaii, and you come back from vacation in Hawaii, which I just did, it was a lot of fun. But and you come back from that, and I say, "Hey, did you see my comet?" You say, "Yeah, I saw your comet in Hawaii." You see what I'm saying? It doesn't mean the comet's in Hawaii. It means you were in Hawaii at the time. So that's one possible interpretation. We, being in the east, saw the star. The other is we saw the star in the eastern sky. Okay? We saw the star. So is it the star that's in the east or the Magi that's in the east? And it's ambiguous. And from my, I'm no Greek expert by any stretch of the imagination, but from what I've been able to ascertain in the Greek, it's also ambiguous. So you can't tell by going back to the original language. I think it's more likely that it's referring to the star. But then there's a perplexing problem that comes up, okay? Because you have these wise men. They themselves are from the east, right? They're from the Persia area. So let's call this east over here. And so here's Jerusalem over in the west. And so they're over here in the east, and they see a star in the east, okay? If that's the case, then why did they go to Jerusalem, which is west, right? Like, hey, the Messiah's star, let's go that way, right? It doesn't make sense. So that's perplexing. But I think there might be a solution to that, and let me give you a hint of it here. The phrase "in the east" in the original Greek language, it's actually at the rising, or at its rising. It's a Greek phrase or word, anatole, at its rising. You might say, well, is that an error in these translations? No, because there is no, at least at this time, there is no Greek word for east. At that time, if you wanted to say east, you'd say at the rising, because the sun rises in the east, right? Sets in the west. And so, and likewise, there's no word for west. If you wanted to say I'm from the west, or I'm headed west, I'm headed toward the setting sun. And again, I don't want to presume on your astronomical knowledge, but it's not just the sun. Everything rises in the east and sets in the west, okay? The stars do, the moon does as well. And that's because we're on a planet that's rotating the other way. And so it's not that they're actually moving that direction, but we're rotating the opposite way. And in fact, there are major Bible translations, such as the English Standard Version and the New Living Translation, which are both pretty respectable versions, that actually translate the passage that way. We saw his star as it rose, or we saw his star at its rising. There are several Bible translations that render it that way. And that would be the most literal word-for-word translation. But is it wrong to translate it in the east? Because, as I've just told you, everything rises in the east, right? So at its rising, that phrase, at its rising, and the phrase in the east are astronomical synonyms. They mean the same thing. If you say, I saw the moon in the east, you saw it when it was rising. If you say, I saw the moon when it was rising, you saw it in the east. There's no difference. And so you say, well, Lyle, why are you making such a big deal out of this if they mean the same thing? Well, because all natural objects rise in the east, set in the west. And it could be that this is not a natural object. And that might indicate why they recognized it as Messiah's star. That one's different. That one rose in the west. I'm going to suggest that that's a possibility there. I'll come back to that a little bit later. But my point is, since this is his star, because it has that uniqueness to it, we can't assume that it's like all other stars and simply is fixed out there in space and because of the rotating earth rises in the east and sets in the west. We can't assume that. And so for this verse and only this verse, it matters whether you take it at its rising or in the east. And I'm going to suggest at its rising would be the most, that's certainly the most literal translation. Okay, in verse 3, then Herod's troubled, and we already saw why that would be. These magi who have the ability to depose kings are coming in asking for the king of the Jews, which they don't apparently think is him. So he's troubled, and what's more disconcerting is that all Jerusalem is troubled with him. The Jews, who should have been ecstatic about the long prophesied Messiah. How many generations of Jews wanted to see the Messiah? And can you imagine being that generation that this is it, this is when it's happening? And of course, there were very few Jews that did respond that way, that were excited by it, but most of them were oblivious to this. They are troubled by the Magi coming asking for the King of the Jews. It bothers them. That's interesting. Again, another indictment against the unrepentant Israel at that time. In verses 4 through 5, Herod summons the Jewish scholars and learns that Christ was prophesied to be born in Bethlehem. And that, again, is from Micah chapter 5, verse 2. So now he's got some additional information. Apparently, the Magi were not familiar with that passage, or they didn't understand its interpretation or its application. So he's now got some information. The Magi have other information. So he meets with them secretly. It's interesting that he meets with them secretly. I think there's a reason for that. If he had met with them openly and all the Jews knew about it, they could warn the Magi, hey, that Herod, he's not to be trusted. He's not a friend of the Jews. He meets with them secretly, so they don't know about it, you see. So he meets with them secretly and asks when they first saw the star. Okay, when did this first appear? And apparently it was some time ago. Because when you look at verse 16, let me turn to it again here. Then when Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he became very enraged and sent and slew all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all its environs from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had ascertained from the Magi. So why did he slay every child 2 and under? Because that had something to do with the timing of the star. Apparently they saw the star about 2 years ago. Now, it's probably a little less than that. I would imagine Herod's covering his bases. He's expanding it a little bit. But my point is, they didn't arrive the next day. The distance from Persia and Jerusalem is great. And so it took the Magi many months to travel there. Of course, it took some months to prepare in advance and to get gifts ready to bring and so on. So again, you've seen the nativity scenes with the shepherds and the manger, and there's the wise men. They weren't there. Okay, because the shepherds were there apparently on the day or maybe the next day, because when the angel appears to the shepherds who were in that area, he says, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David." So they knew the day when he was born, and they immediately go up to see him. And it's less than a day's distance from where they're at. So they might have seen him on the very day that Christ was born. The Magi arrive probably a year later. Okay, and of course, there's additional information that would lead you to believe that, even if you didn't have this verse. The fact that Jesus is in a house when they arrive. Jesus is referred to as a child, not a baby. He's apparently a toddler. Now, those aren't conclusive, because there are different ways you could read that. But also the fact that the Magi bring gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They bring gold, right, to Joseph and Mary. And remember, when Joseph and Mary go to the temple for the rituals surrounding Jesus, because they have to offer a sacrifice, right, for the firstborn child, you're supposed to offer a lamb, but instead they offer two turtle doves. There was a provision in Old Testament law. If you were too poor to afford a lamb, you could substitute turtle doves. And so the fact that they were still poor at that time indicates they had not been yet given gold by the wise men, you see. So there's lots of different ways you can realize that the wise men came at a later time. In verse 8, he sends them to Bethlehem. He gives them that information that his scholars had reported to him, and asks them to report back to him so that he might come and worship the child too. And of course, we know he has no intention of that. He's wanting to get that information so he can assassinate the Christ. In verse 9, the Magi see the star again. It's significant that they saw the star in the east, because when they're meeting with Herod, he asks them when they saw the star, and they'd already seen it. And then after they meet with Herod, they see the star again. That's significant that they see the star at least on two occasions. Once when they're in the east, in the Persia area, and then another time after meeting with Herod. Why is that important? Because it blows away 90% of the explanations for the Christmas star. Most of them are one-time events, okay? But they saw the star on at least two occasions, and perhaps throughout their journey. It's just apparently when they were right at Jerusalem. they didn't see it. And then it says, the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over where the child was. And that eliminates the remaining explanations, because most natural objects don't lead you and then stand over where the child was. And I've gone back, I've looked at the Greek on that. It means what it says. The star stood over where the child was, meaning it was stationary over the location of Christ's house. And apparently the house, not just Bethlehem. They already knew he was in Bethlehem. They didn't need the star for that, right? Yet it went ahead of them, either real or apparent motion. The Bible does use language of appearance. So the star seems to be moving ahead of them. In any case, it arrives in Bethlehem over the house of Christ before they do. And that's how they know where to go. They knew he was in Bethlehem. That wasn't in question. Herod had told them that. Verse 10, and when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And that might perplex you as well. Well, they'd seen it before. Why are they so excited now? Well, we can make some reasonable guesses about that. Remember, apparently the star wasn't guiding them when they came to Jerusalem. Otherwise, they would have gone straight to Bethlehem. They came to Jerusalem, the capital city, first, which suggests the star wasn't guiding them at that time and perhaps hadn't been for some time. And I would imagine that the Magi, at this point, after they've met with Herod, are very discouraged. Because, you know, they've made this, they're very excited about seeing the Messiah, and then clouds move in and they don't know where he's at. They can't see the star anymore. And so they're asking the Jews, and the Jews don't even seem to know about him. And they meet with Herod, and Herod doesn't know about the star. They're very discouraged. Does God really want us to see the Messiah? You know, I mean, we've got clouded out. We've got all the, you know, the Jews don't seem to even know about it. Did we interpret the prophecy properly? And then they see the star again, and they rejoice with exceedingly great. Oh, yes, God is with, and we're close. It's high now. You can see we're very close. We're maybe a day's journey away from seeing the King of Kings, Lord of Lords. That's awesome. Of course, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And they came into the house and saw the child with Mary his mother, the child, not the baby, the child with Mary his mother. And they fell down and worshipped him, and opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And it's interesting that they brought those gifts, because in the Old Testament, you can see a number of cases where subservient states would present gifts to their overlord state. A lot of times one nation would either take over another, or the smaller nation would become a subservient to a greater nation to enjoy its protection. And the subservient state would offer gifts, tributes to the superior state. And the frequent gifts that were offered were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Isn't that interesting? That's a way of saying, okay, we have our own king for our nation, but you are the King of Kings. And so that's the indication that the Magi recognized that even though they had their own king in their area, that Jesus is the King of Kings, indicating that they're subservient to him. They're submitting to his kingdom. Very interesting. Okay, so now that we have that kind of background information, we're in a position to say, what was this star? I've kind of hinted at it, but there have been a number of possibilities that have been suggested. I first of all have to point out, it doesn't have to be a star in the modern astronomical sense of a glowing ball of hydrogen gas trillions of miles away. That's one possibility. That is a star. But the Greek word for star, aster, would include anything that is sort of a point-like object, a bright luminous object in the night sky. It would include planets, for example. See, in the modern system, planets are not called stars because they have their own classification. But in the ancient world, planets were stars. Okay, in fact, they were wandering stars. That's what the word planet means. It's a wanderer. It's a wandering star. So in the ancient world, you had the fixed stars, fixed relative to each other. They do rise and set due to Earth's rotation. But if you could turn off Earth's rotation, all the stars would be fixed and stationary, except the planets. And the planets move with respect to the background stars. And there were five that were known to the ancient world, five of these wandering stars. A comet would count, too. A comet would fall under that Greek term, aster. A comet is a hairy star. That's what comet means. It means long hair, because they have the tails. Yeah, that's what it means. A small moon. Now, our moon probably would not be called a star because it's not point-like. And right now, Earth has only one moon. But you might say, well, maybe at the time of Christ, it had a second small moon orbiting it. If it was small enough and point-like, that would fall under the classification of a star. Certainly. So my point is, it doesn't have to be a ball of hydrogen gas. We need to interpret the terms according to the way they were used at that time. And for that reason, since it doesn't have to be a fixed star, people have speculated, all kinds of speculations. People have said, well, maybe it's a planet, maybe it's a comet, maybe it's another moon, maybe it's a supernova, an exploding star. That'd be pretty spectacular. Or maybe it's a conjunction of planets. A conjunction is where one planet passes by either a bright star or passes by another planet. When two objects come close together in the sky, that's a conjunction. They don't have to touch, they just have to come close. And the closest point is the conjunction. One of the more popular positions is that the star was a triple conjunction of Jupiter and Regulus. I have to explain that a little bit. Planets, if we turn off Earth's rotation and we're just watching the motion of planets with respect to the background stars, what they do is they normally travel west to east in our night sky. But once a year, they slow down and stop and then turn around and go backwards a little bit and then stop and then go forward again. And they do this repeat. If you trace their path, it's like this, and so on, okay? And that's because when they're doing that little loop, that's when Earth is passing them, because we're on the inside track compared to these outer planets, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And so when we pass them, they seem to be going backwards by comparison. I was in track when I was young. I wasn't very good at it. And so I'm running, and then the guy in the inside track, is running past me, and I seem to be going backwards because it's the same thing. anyway, so that's called retrograde motion. So you have these conjunctions. It's possible to have a conjunction. If the conjunction happens about the time of that retrograde motion, you can have this. You can have the planet there and then conjunct again and then conjunct a third time. That's a triple conjunction, and they do happen. And it turns out there was one in 3 BC. In 2 BC, because it takes a few months for him to do it. September 13th, 3 BC, Jupiter conjuncts Regulus, and then it does its retrograde loop and conjuncts again, and then conjuncts a third time. Pretty neat. Pretty spectacular. Rare. Well, not that rare. I've seen conjunctions before. But for a triple conjunction of Jupiter and Regulus, it was a pretty bright star. You'd say, well, that's kind of neat. That might have some significance to the ancient world. But the problem is, how do you call a conjunction a star? It's two stars. And Jupiter already has a name, and the Magi would have been familiar with that. If they wanted to say, we saw Jupiter conjunct with Regulus, they could have said, we saw Jupiter conjunct with Regulus. We saw Jupiter and Regulus come together. That's not what they said. They said, we saw his star. And I don't see how you can make two stars into his star, with one possible exception that I'll come to in a minute. So I don't think that conjunction idea works. And the timing is perhaps wrong, too, because it's 3 BC and 2 BC, most scholars think around 4 BC would be closer to the birth of Christ. We don't know for sure, but the timing could be off there. Shortly after that, there was another conjunction, this time of Jupiter and Venus. So a planet passes by another planet. And this happened on June 17th, 2 BC. And the interesting thing about this one is it was very close, so close that the two objects probably looked like one object in the night sky. That's pretty spectacular. Now, conjunctions of Venus and Jupiter are common. They happen roughly once every 13 months on average. I've seen several. So they're pretty common. But the spectacular thing about this one is they were so close they would have appeared like one object, perhaps. And that's pretty spectacular. That's pretty neat. And so you say, well, maybe that could be called one star, because they're that close to the eye, it would appear like one star. Pretty neat. But the problem is that happens, it only lasts one night where they're actually one star. They only last one evening. And remember, they saw the star at least twice, remember that? And the previous conjunction, they probably would not have looked like one object. So you see, I don't think that qualifies as the Christmas star. And more importantly, there's no way that these two naturally moving objects could stand over where the child was, at least not for any length of time. I mean, they might look like it for a few minutes, and then 15 minutes later, because of the rotation of the Earth, they've moved on. And so my point is, it does not fit the description of verse 9. And a lot of folks just overlook that, and there are very few that try to bend the text to this interpretation. There's a very popular DVD on the Christmas star that circulates that promotes this view, that it's a conjunction of Venus and Jupiter. And he says, well, the star stopping, that's the retrograde motion. That's where Jupiter stops and then backs up. But it doesn't actually really stop because it makes a little circle. So it slows and then it reverses, but it's moving up a little bit at the time, you see. So it never really stops. So I don't think that matches the text. And so in order to have this, in order to have an object standing over Bethlehem, how are you going to do that with a natural object? Well, today we have the North Star. The North Star stands right over Earth's North Pole, and it's able to do that because as Earth's rotating, the pole axis doesn't change. You see, and there happens to be a star lined up pretty close with Earth's North Pole. It's less than 1 degree away. And so as Earth rotates, that star remains in that spot. And so the North Star does stand right over Earth's North Pole. But the problem is, two problems, Bethlehem is not on the North Pole. That's one problem. And the other one, which you may not know about, there was no North Star at the time of Christ's earthly ministry. The star was there, but Earth's pole axis shifts with time, and it was pointed to an empty region in space. So there were no stars that were stationary either over the North or South Pole at the time of Christ's earthly ministry. So it can't be the North Star. There's an interesting irony here. In order for it to appear stationary, it has to move. Isn't that interesting? In order for it to be stationary, it's got to move. Because Earth's moving, and Bethlehem is on a rotating planet. And so in order for that star to be standing over Bethlehem and to lead the Magi there, it has to remain over the Earth like that. It has to move west to east pretty quick. And that eliminates planets. Planets do move west to east, but not nearly fast enough. The Earth rotates much faster than planets move. And so they can't remain over Bethlehem for any period of time. That's not going to work. The one last possibility is what we would call a geostationary satellite. And there are now artificial versions of these that have been launched out. A geostationary satellite is one that's been launched out pretty far away from the Earth to where its orbital speed is the same as the speed at which Earth rotates. And you can't, they're too faint to be seen naked eye because they're pretty far away. The satellites that you can see naked eye are close and they orbit much quicker than the Earth rotates. But I have seen a geostationary satellite. I was looking in the telescope one time at a star field, and the telescope's tracking with the stars. It's compensating for Earth's rotation, right? And I see this one star very slowly drifting. And I'm like, oh, it's too slow to be a normal satellite. Oh, it's got to be a geostationary satellite. And I turned off the clock drive to let the stars drift, and sure enough, the satellite remains stationary then because it's following the Earth as it rotates. Neat. God could have created that. He could have created a second moon that was in a geostationary orbit. But the problem is that only works over the equator. You see, a circle, an object has to orbit around Earth's center. And so if you put it up at a higher latitude, which you'd need for Bethlehem, the orbit has to cross the equator and then go below like that, you see. And so my point is, Bethlehem is not on the equator, and so a geostationary satellite won't work. It won't remain over that position. Bethlehem is a latitude of 31.7. It's just 1 degree lower than we are here, actually. So you can't do that. That's why those of you, if you have a satellite dish, it's pointed to the south. Right? It's not pointed straight up, it's pointed to the south, because the geostationary satellites have to orbit over Earth's equator and nowhere else. So I think we've exhausted all natural phenomena, at least that I know about. There is no natural phenomena that can remain suspended over a particular location on Earth that's not the North Pole or the equator for any period of time, let alone 2 years. It had to be close to 2 years, right, that this thing lasted. And so my hypothesis is that the Christmas star was a supernatural manifestation of God's power. It was something that God created supernaturally. It rose from Bethlehem and then stood over there. The Magi from the Persia area would have seen it, and they would have traveled toward it. And the nice thing about this explanation, and again, I'm going beyond the text, and so you should feel free to reject that if you think that there's a better explanation. But the nice thing about this is it simultaneously resolves five difficulties in the text. There are five things in the text that are sort of hard to explain, but if you believe the star is a supernatural manifestation of God's power that was created over Christ at his birth and then rose from there and led the Magi and just hovered there, not particularly bright, that resolves all five of these difficulties. The first one is, why did the wise men go west if the star was in the east? And I'm suggesting to you they saw the star at its rising, which for natural objects is in the east. But this star rose in the west, okay? Because from Persia, you look west, you see Israel, and the star rises from Israel, okay? And so that explains why they went west. It explains why they recognized it as his star. The Magi were experts in astronomy, and they knew that all natural objects move, rise in the east, set in the west. And they see this one star rising in the west. They knew that could not be accounted for by any natural phenomenon. They knew that in their entire lives of having studied the heavens, nothing does that. Nothing rises in the west. Today you can see that because we have artificial satellites that do that. Okay, but before 1957, nothing did that. Before Sputnik, there was nothing that would rise in the west and set in the east. So this thing rises and then it hovers there, okay, just suspended there in space. And they would recognize that as supernatural, at least. It explains why only the Magi noticed it, because those folks who are not all that familiar with the night sky would not recognize a star that's not particularly bright that doesn't belong in that constellation. The Magi would have been familiar with the constellations, and they would have known there's an extra star in that one, and it rose in the west, unlike any natural star. It also explains Balaam's prophecy in Numbers 24:17, which says a star will rise from Israel, right? A scepter will rise from Israel. A star will come forth from Jacob. This star literally rose from Israel, okay? And so you can imagine that, and then it stood over where the child was, and no natural object would do that, but a supernatural creation of God would. So you can imagine the Magi who are looking for signs of the Messiah, okay, and then they see, on one night, they see a star rise over Israel, and they're reminded of Numbers 24:17. Oh, that's got to be the Messiah. All natural stars are setting in that direction. There's one star that's rising. It's got to be supernatural. It fulfills Numbers 24:17 because it's rising over Israel, and they would have recognized that has to be the Messiah's star. Has to be. There's no other explanation for it. So, let's see. How are we doing time-wise? Good? Okay. Because I wanted to mention a little bit more about what that means for it to be a supernatural manifestation of God's power or miracle. Because a lot of Christians have a misconception about that. A lot of folks think that God created the universe and it sort of runs like a clock. It sort of runs on its own. And then a miracle or supernatural activity would be when God sort of steps in and intervenes with that machine. That really is not a biblical view. The biblical view is that God constantly upholds the universe by the word of his power. Hebrews 1:3 teaches that. And so the universe is not something that can operate independent from God. It can't. God is constantly upholding it. God is causing the universe to behave in the way that it does. Wrap your mind around that for a moment. Every electron around every atom in your body, the reason it orbits that way is because God's making it orbit that way. That's awesome. You can't even keep track of that, and yet God's causing it. And there's this misconception, well, we don't need God anymore because we know that atoms are held together by forces of electromagnetism and the planets are held together by gravity. You know, there are these laws of nature that explain it. Laws of nature are not a replacement for God's power. They're an example of God's power, okay? Gravity is not something that exists independent from God. Gravity is the name we give to the fact that God causes things to move in that way. And so this idea that the universe can exist on its own and it's its own entity and then God intervenes is not a biblical position. That's sort of a quasi-deistic position. The biblical position is that God upholds everything, and he normally does it in a very consistent and predictable way, which we call laws of nature. Laws of nature are descriptions of the normal, consistent way that God upholds his creation. That's how I, as a Christian, would define laws of nature. They're not something that God created. They're descriptions for what God does. Okay, the way he normally upholds the universe. And you might say, well, how can that be? Because they seem impersonal and they seem very mathematical. Well, that tells you something about how God thinks. God thinks very mathematically, and he upholds the universe in a consistent way for our benefit, because it would be impossible to do science if he didn't. It would be impossible to do technology if God were constantly changing the way he upheld things. He does it in a consistent way for our benefit so that we can understand the universe and harness it in many respects. So my point here is that laws of nature are not a replacement for God's power. They are God's power. They're a description of what God normally does. A supernatural action, therefore, would be when God does something in an unusual way. He does something different that goes beyond the normal, consistent way that he upholds the universe. And so it's interesting to me that the atheist demands a miracle from God. He says if God would stop the rotation of the earth right now for, say, a day, which God has done, by the way, but he can do that. He says, if that happened, then I'd believe in God. That would prove to me that God exists. I would say, no, it's not the violation of laws of nature that demonstrate God's existence. It's the laws of nature that demonstrate God's existence, you see. It's the fact that the earth does orbit in a way that's predictable and so on. The fact that the sun will rise tomorrow is proof of God. The secular philosopher David Hume was utterly stumped on this issue. If you think I'm just making this up, and no scholars have come up with secular explanations for why there's this uniformity in nature, no, they haven't. Read David Hume. He's an atheist, and he tried to come up with an atheistic explanation for how it is we can know that the sun will rise tomorrow, and he couldn't. And it'll do no good to say, well, it always has, because unless you assume that there's already uniformity in nature, and therefore what has happened is a good predictor of what will happen, then you can't make any assumptions about just because it was that way, it'll be that way in the future. You can't assume that unless you already knew about uniformity some other way. It's only the Christian God who's beyond time, who's in a position to tell us what the future will be like, and in fact actively controls the future, who's in a position to tell us, yes, I'm going to uphold things in a consistent way, which he's promised in Genesis 8:22, that the basic cycles of nature will be in the future as they have been in the past, as long as the earth remains. But of course, God is free to do things in a small way that temporarily, he can uphold the universe in a temporarily different way to accomplish something extraordinary, which he sometimes does. And so it's not a problem for us to have a supernatural manifestation of God's power, something that God temporarily created for the purpose of announcing Christ's birth, that did things that no natural object can do, namely standing over where the child was, leading the Magi, if my interpretation's right, rising in the west over Israel, at least from the perspective of Persia, it would be rising in the west. From all positions, it would be supernatural, right? Because if you're in the south, it rises in the north. Nothing natural rises in the north. If you're from the north, it rises in the south. Everywhere it rises over Israel. The only place it would be rising in the east is if you live in the Mediterranean Sea, which most people don't. And even there, it would rise and then it would stop. So you would still recognize it as an unusual manifestation of God's power. So it's something that's readily recognizable as miraculous, as something that is an unusual way for God to demonstrate his glory and all for his power. So if I can kind of sum it up, what I believe happened was that the Christmas star was a supernatural manifestation of God's power, a supernatural light source, not particularly bright, but bright enough to be seen from Persia, being over Bethlehem. It rises over the location of Christ, which from Persia, you know it's over Israel, but you can't tell if it's Bethlehem or Jerusalem. They're indistinguishable from that distance. And so the Magi make the trek, taking many months, perhaps over a year. Maximum would be 2 years, right? Because we know that's the age that Herod used to slay the offspring, the male children. From the perspective of those in Persia, the star would have risen in the west, and they would have immediately recognized that as a supernatural star. Nothing natural rises in the west. And so they knew that must be his star, perhaps the fulfillment of the prophecy of Balaam, that a star will rise over Israel. That's the Messiah's star. They were already looking for something because they knew the 70 weeks was about to expire. And so they knew the timing was right. They make the journey to Jerusalem, taking many months. The star apparently is not visible when they arrive in Jerusalem, because they have to ask, where is he who's been born king of the Jews? They're probably very dismayed that none of the Jews even know about it. Very surprising to them, perhaps, and very discouraging to them. And so Herod finally meets with them and tells them he's in Bethlehem, and they tell him the timing of the star, because even Herod didn't know when the star appeared. They were not familiar with it, not being a particularly bright star, and not expecting the Messiah, not looking for it. Then after they've met with Herod, finally they see the star again, and so they know, we're close now. And it's very high at that point, because they're very close to it, and maybe a little bit brighter too, since they are closer to it. And hovering over Bethlehem, they know he's in Bethlehem, and so they travel there, and apparently it leads them to the house, because they already knew he was in Bethlehem. And so I think the Christmas card picture there is not too far off, with the star actually hovering over the house. I think that's probably the case. And so it seems fitting to me that the supernatural birth of the Messiah, the King of Kings, would be accompanied by supernatural activity in the heaven. I think that's quite fitting. And of course, the relevance for today is, you know, God gives abundant evidence of his existence, of who he is, and in the natural world. And of course, when we read the scriptures, there's a bell ringing within us. We recognize that as Christ's word, right? My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. And so we recognize that. And so it's interesting to me that of all the people that should have been expecting the Messiah, should have been looking for it, certainly the Jews, they didn't. It was these Gentiles from a pagan nation that saw it and responded. And so even today, the Holy Spirit is commanding everyone everywhere to repent, and pulling on our hearts and so on. And you know, are you going to respond to that? Are you going to be like the Magi who respond to that star, who follow it, and are led to Christ? Are you going to be like those who, hey, we're God's people because we're in Israel? I mean, a lot of Christians think that way. Hey, I go to church. I'm part of God's people. Well, hey, if you haven't responded to the light, you're not, right? And so that's the message for us today, I think.